So again, as Ashley said, I work at Glenbrook South High School. I'm the transition specialist there. I've been there for 12 years. I love what I do. I'm super passionate about this. I think that there is a place for everyone. And whether that's college or a different type of program, our job is to help you find what that appropriate placement is. I like to say all the time, I am not a dream destroyer. So lots of students will come into my office and they'll say, you know, I want to be a doctor. I want to be a veterinarian. And maybe I think that's a completely unrealistic goal, but my job is to figure out from the student why they're interested in that field and what are those nuggets and how can we make a job or a profession that's going to meet both their skills as well as their interest areas. Because in the end, if you don't love what you do, you're not going to be able to be successful at it. So let's talk a little bit about college, right? So I think the first question that you need to ask your son or daughter is, why college? So what is the purpose of that degree? What is the purpose of the college experience? So some students might say, well, the purpose is I want to be a, you know, a businessman and I need a business degree in order to get that. Some people might say the purpose is because I want to go and have a good time with a bunch of kids my age. So you have to figure out what is the purpose of the college experience for that student. The second one is, what is the purpose of that college degree? So why are we getting the college degree? So that you can be more equipped to find a job, so that you can make more money someday. You know, if your student says, I really am interested in being a cosmetologist, do they need a college degree to do that? No, and that's okay, because not everyone needs a college degree. So making sure that that the experience that they're looking for, as well as the degree, are something that match their interests and goals. And what will be the benefit? Right, so how, at the end of the day, when they get that diploma, they walk across the stage, what's the benefit going to be to the student? Okay, many of us have attended college and we know what that benefit was. It got us a better job, it prepared us for a career. What is the benefit for the student? And then what do we need to do? What do we need to work on? What are the skills that we need to have in order to reach that goal of a college degree? So when we talk, you know, I'm not sure where all of you live, I'm not sure if you're all in these areas, but, you know, in Glenview, everyone goes to college, right? That's just what we all say. What are you doing after high school? College. They don't say anything else. So part of it is the communities that we live in. The myth is that everybody goes to college, that's the next step, it just happens. The truth is that a lot of people have many different paths to get what they want. So when we talk about the traditional college experience, it's the one we're all selling, right? You're 4 years, you get to live in a dorm, you have a major, you have activities, and you finally supports, and everything is great, right? That is a great experience. Wonderful, many students have this traditional college experience. But you know what? It's not for everybody. And there are ways to make it, or to find colleges, or to find programs that offer you some alternatives to this. So when I think of non-traditional college experience, one of the first things I think of is location. So most students will say, I want to go away. Most of my students want to go to California, so do I. It's a great place, but it's really far away and you can never come home. So location, right? It doesn't have to be away. We live in Chicago, one of the greatest cities for education in the United States. There are so many options in our city for places that you can go and get great classes. And on top of that, you don't have to live on campus. You don't necessarily have to take a full load. You could take one class at a college and start getting that college experience. There's nothing wrong with that. Great city. Accommodate above and beyond. So every school will have a different service delivery, right? So some schools will offer only accommodations. They will offer you your extended time, your small group, the things that a lot of the students know that they can get. But there are many colleges that go above and beyond that. So they offer special programs, executive functioning tutors, separate dorm areas, all sorts of different things that they can offer for students that need those accommodations above and beyond what a typical student would be able to get. More than 4 years. Now, a lot of colleges for traditional students will only tell you their six-year graduation rates, right? Because kids aren't graduating 4 years anymore. And I'm talking about the typical student, again, that goes off without a disability. So it might take more than 4 years. And that, there's nothing wrong with that, but just to keep that in mind. Started at 18, and they talked a little bit about a student that wasn't ready to go away at 18 for a variety of reasons. And so you have to think about that too. Do they have to start at 18? Or is there some work you can do before then that gets them to that goal where they're going to be successful, but maybe it's at 19 or 20? Parent involvement in the college educational experience. So most colleges aren't going to talk to the parents. That's really scary. Okay, you have advocated for this child their whole entire life, and then all of a sudden, you're cut off. That is a really scary thing. So, how can you still be involved in that process? How can you still be involved to make sure that the things that you need to happen for your student are still happening? So, these are some things that we've learned. Test scores and transcripts are not necessarily an indicator for success. You know, I have students every year that score a 36 on the ACT, or at least the last 2 years I have. Okay? That's not a guarantee that that student's going to be successful in college. Okay? There are many skills that that student needs beyond their educational abilities to be able to be successful, and we're going to talk about some of those. So, you know, thinking about college readiness, not just as academic. So oftentimes when you go into a guidance counselor's office, you say, oh, they have a 3.0 GPA and a 21 on the ACT. Here are the schools that are going to be good fits for them. But really, when you're looking for a student with a disability, you have to look broader than that. You have to look at what about the college is a good fit for that student. So looking at the independent living options, what are the options for where students live? The academic pieces obviously are important. The social, so do they have anything that gets kids going? Do they have freshman interest groups? Do they have fraternities? What do they have that get kids connected right from the start? And then the medical piece, you know, making sure that students are ready to transition from their medications and any social work or psychiatric services that they have. So the number one thing I believe is important is self-reflection by the parent and the student, okay? Understanding your strengths and weaknesses, understanding what you are good at and what you need help with. Is there anyone in this room that doesn't need help? Everybody needs help at some point in their life. So making sure that you understand, you know what, it's really hard for me to do X. And when I get to X, I have to go ask somebody for assistance. It's one of the biggest problems our students have is going and advocating and asking for that help. Goals, can they set goals? You know, what do they need to do? They say, you know what, I need to get into the regular education math class at college. Here are the steps I need to do in order to get there. Wellness, how do they take care of themselves, both mentally and physically? Choice making, can they make a choice for themselves? Or are they relying on somebody else to make a choice? A lot of times I'll have students in my office and I'll say, what do you want to do after high school? And they look at their parent, right? That's not helping us once they leave us. We have to let them answer some of those questions. Problem solving. So many times if you're in a novel situation, which is another thing, so they go into the cafeteria the first day and they have their tray and they don't know where to sit, right? How are they gonna problem solve those novel situations? And the ability to ask for help, which I will say about 100 times in this presentation, that ability to say, I need help, is one of the most crucial things that your student can have for success. So just a couple categories to think about, health and safety. So maintaining hygiene independently, safety on the internet and in the community, those are big issues with our teenagers. I'm glad I grew up without social media, but they are not growing up without social media, and it is all over the place. Make sure they understand the implications of social media and what you put out there. Managing behaviors. You know, I have a lot of students that maybe after they're not happy with the math test, go up to the professor and say, you know, this is crap. You gave me the wrong score. You gave me whatever. You can't confront a professor like that in the college environment. It's not going to go well for you. So making sure if that happens in high school, you have those conversations about, we understand and you're in a protected environment right now and the social worker can meet with you and the speech pathologist can meet with you and we can all get together and problem solve this, but what happens next year, right? What happens when you're not in this environment where everybody knows you? Knowing what to do in an emergency. Again, doctors and medications, making sure that you know what you need in order to be healthy. And as well as, I highly recommend if you're going to go out of state for a college, that you find a psychiatrist or a mental health professional in that community that your child is connected with before they start, just in case anything goes wrong. Social peer relationships. Talking about all of these pieces of getting out of your dorm room, right? I think every parent's biggest fear, or at least with the boys, is that they're going to go and play video games in their dorm room and never come out again, right? They're just going to sit in the bed, play the video games, and the parents are going to be writing the $15,000 check and sending it off for their kid to sit in their dorm room and play video games. Scary, right? Number one, don't send the kid with the video system. That would be my first thing. But making sure they have some built-in ways to be social. And I talked about this earlier. You know, freshman interest groups are big on campuses where students are grouped by their major. Fraternities, different things. Anything that you can socially connect your student to. Also, counseling centers at many of the campuses are now offering groups, social groups, like they do in high school. So social groups for students that are on the autism spectrum. So social groups for kids that have had eating disorders, all sorts of things. So look at the counseling center on the website of the college to see what groups that they have so that the student can make some connections that way. So everything along those lines, just making sure that they have something set up that they know where to find a peer. Home living. So I ask students all the time, you know, if you were home and it was lunch and your parents weren't around, what would you cook? What do you think they all say?
I think that's pretty advanced. Right?
Chicken nuggets?
A sandwich. They all say, I'd make a sandwich, right? That's fine, that's food, right? If we can make a sandwich, we're good. Okay, so put the turkey on, whatever. But they need to be able to make something for themselves. Wash the dishes, making their bed, cleaning, laundry, all of these things that they're going to be doing in a dorm room by themselves. There's no reason they can't be doing these things now. And I would say that to a group of any parents that are their kids on the way to college. Because these are things that we aren't teaching our students. I certainly went away to college without being able to do laundry and kind of was like faking, watching my roommate do it, you know, and figured it out. But again, you want to make sure that you're giving them some exposure to this. Many of our students these days leave high school without a driver's license. And that's a choice a lot of them make. They don't feel confident driving. They don't feel like they need to drive. So how are they going to get around? Can they use the bus system? Are they at a place like Madison or one of the, you know, college campuses that's really easy to walk around and navigate? How are they going to do that? And if you are going to send them away, will they be able to navigate the airport to come home by themselves? So keep that in mind as well. I would say this is the number one thing that is our students are struggling with at college, and that is executive functioning. Okay, making sure that you are organized, that your stuff is put together, that you know how to chunk an assignment, to break it up, to manage studying time, to edit. All of these things are so incredibly crucial to being a successful human being, right? Not just to being a successful student. We all do this. If you're, you know, in any sort of job, you're doing this every day. These are things that are crucial to life. So making sure that you're continuing to work on these skills in high school. And if you know and you're confident that your student doesn't have these skills at the next level, make sure they're going to a program where you can get some of this help, or make sure they're finding somebody on campus that's going to help them with this. A lot of times you can hire somebody who's a junior or senior student who can come and help you organize and plan your week. Something that's going to get them going on this executive functioning. So when I look at the biggest factors for why kids are successful in college, it's these two things. They know how to problem solve, and they know how to ask for help. And really, they should be reversed, because one of the best ways to problem solve is to ask for help, right? So making sure in the situation, you know, it's very common that, you know, they're having a problem with a teacher in high school, or they're having a problem with a friend, and you maybe step in, right, to problem solve with them. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Teach that problem solving, talk it out with them, and encourage them to start doing some of the other pieces on their own. You email your teacher, I'll sit with you and watch you do it, but you do it. Again, just that self-determination, that advocacy, those are the most important things that we could look at. So don't start fresh. That's another piece of advice. A lot of the students that are in my office are like, no, high school is one thing, college is a fresh start. I'm not gonna use my accommodations anymore because I'm not gonna need them. Set yourself up for success. I have known from experience that college disability offices, most of them will still talk to parents while the kid's still in high school, while you're looking at the school. Make those connections when you can still have those conversations. Because come fall, when your student's enrolled there, they may or may not talk to you. Some schools will let you sign up for a waiver and they will talk to you, but many won't. So make those connections and try to coach your child through some of those conversations, you know, modeling all the things that we do as parents to make sure that they are ready to go. You know, go with what works. What worked for you in high school? What was making you successful? And, you know, be realistic. A lot of students say, oh, I'm gonna go away, I'm gonna take 15 hours, I'm gonna do all this. It's tough to transition to college. Start slow, find success, move from there. And my biggest thing, and I talk about this a lot with families, is allow your child to fail in high school when it's safe. And you can learn from that. Because when they fail in college, no one's gonna be there to catch them and you know, wrap the services around and get the team activated and get everybody going. So watch some of that failure and see what they can learn from it. So who can help you before you go? So my role is a transition specialist. Your high school should have somebody like me in it. There's gotta be somebody, that's what I'll say. Find that person, ask your special ed case manager who that person is, or your guidance counselor. I actually bridge two departments. I'm between special ed and guidance because I work with students with IEPs and 504s. So just making sure you find that person. Your case manager probably knows your student best academically. Talk to that person about what they need and what are the things that they've really mastered. I love working with our speech-language pathologist. If your child is ever going to interview for a college or a job, have them work with a speech-language pathologist. Amazing at asking those questions, preparing for that interview. The social worker, today I was in a meeting with a student who's a senior, and I went into the social work session to talk about some of these things that are a little bit scary about transitioning, because it is scary to transition. Guidance counselor, we already talked about. Summer programs, great options at a lot of schools to get a feel of what it's like to be in college. Also for you as a parent to be like, oh boy, there's something we need to work on before they leave, okay? Choices, which is an organization I'm involved with. It is a group of high schools in the North Suburbs that put on a fair specifically for students with disabilities. Our fair next year is October 24th. Fourth, I think, I'll get you that date, at Glover North High School this year. The service providers from the colleges actually come to the fair. Anyone is welcome, even the people that aren't going to the high schools that we work at. And they talk to the students about, you know, what they need, what programs and services that they offer. So it's a wonderful program. The other thing about the Choices website is that we have a book on there that we publish every year. And it is a list of all of the colleges that work with students with disabilities, as well as all the separate programs. So there is a list of all the colleges that really are just known for being helpful to students with disabilities. And then the next section is actually schools with special programs. And those are broken down by disability as well, because if you start looking, you'll see that there's some schools that are really specific to LD, some that are really specific to autism, across the board. So making sure that information is out there. You are welcome to it. It's a free download. You go to the Post-Secondary Choices website and the booklet's on there. Download it for free. It's like 100 pages. It has all sorts of helpful information on the process as well as that list of schools. Options is another fair that is sort of a little bit different than colleges. They have a lot of alternative programs as well. So, when I think of college, I think of post-secondary planning, not just that college piece. There are many programs out there that can help and support your student. We happen to have a fantastic transition services at our school where we have students that, you know, maybe attend one class at Oakton, get some support with finding a job, continue some of that community employment piece and community navigation. So look at your transition programs at your schools and your transition services at your schools. Community colleges offer many different types of degrees. Again, you know, I could list all these out, but the Choices website has all of this on there. So I'm also happy if you want me to send you a list, but there's many different types of programs. If your student has a Department of Rehabilitation Services grant, or I'm sorry, a certification, they have a lot of funded training programs. Like right now they have one in manufacturing where a student actually does an internship, they learn all about the manufacturing, and then they go and actually get hired by these companies. Really great, huge, expanding field. And manufacturing isn't nuts and bolts. I mean, they're making the meals for airlines, and they're making clothing, and all sorts of different things. Alternative college programs. So things that are maybe like a college feel, but have a not college requirements. So an example of that would be like a Shepherd's College up in Wisconsin, where you can major in culinary or horticulture. It's not really a college. However, it has a very academic college type feel. You live on campus, you get a degree, etc. Gap years, which are, you know, always popular with some students, and that's when you take a year off to go sort of grow as a human being. Four-year colleges with accommodations, as well as four-year colleges with full support programs. So you have those kind of two layers, those colleges that offer really the robust accommodations, but then those colleges that offer full support programs, like Lynn and, you know, SALT at University of Arizona, Loras, Wisconsin Whitewater, Oshkosh, those type of schools that offer really supportive programs. So again, just think about that support and how essential the support is. The academic, that counseling, finding a social worker or a psychiatrist in the community if there's any mental health concerns. Looking at people like executive functioning tutors, life coaches, your resident advisor. You know, that might be someone when you move your student into a dorm that you go down and meet and say, hey, you know, my student has some unique qualities that I would love for you to know about. You know, maybe you could help him find somebody to go to dinner with. So utilize the supports that you have both in the high school and in the college to ensure that you set your student up for a successful transition. And I think the last piece I want to talk about is who's managing the case, right? You have this huge team throughout high school, everybody's helping you and supporting you, and now you're sort of on your own. So who is managing it? And it really is the parent and the student. You know, the student certainly is going to be the person at the forefront. They're going to be doing the majority of the work. However, I can't imagine any of you parents are going to take a back seat and just be like, good luck, right? You're still going to manage. You're still going to help. You're still going to problem solve. You're just going to have to do it from a little bit of a distance. So just be an advocate. Continue to be an advocate for your child. You know, for the students, continue to be self-advocates. Be a creative thinker. You know, sometimes there's not just one path to something. Try to think creatively. Engage your community. Think of partnerships. Think of ways that you can make sure that your student is going to be successful in their community. And then as well as any agencies that might be able to help and support you in that next step. So that is the end of my presentation. I hope I didn't go too long, too short. Any questions? Yes.
You mentioned something about DRS here, and one of the colleges that we looked at suggested we should talk to our DRS to see if they would pay for any of the extra support. Are you familiar with that?
Yes. So DRS has a community college grant right now, so they are offering for students that qualify and go through a process some money towards community college. But if a student's not attending community college, they're actually helping to transfer the case so that some of the services can be covered from DRS through the university.
Where are the
out of state?
I'm sorry? Yes.
Out of state as well?
Well, that's a good question. The schools I've seen it at, like I know Illinois State has a DRS representative, but I would imagine, yes, it could be out of state.
So we're in Illinois, we went to a Wisconsin school. They would only pay whatever the rate would be in Illinois. So whatever they would give you if you were going to Illinois school would be the same as if you were going to school out of state. Or maybe like if you were a resident of Wisconsin, they would give you a different amount. So your Illinois dollar amount is set even if you go out of state.
But there are, I would ask your DRS rep that, because there are definitely incentives right now for college and for students with disabilities, as well as there are college campuses that have a DRS person on their campus that's helping support some of those options. Yes?
What are the qualifying criteria?
For DRS, a student with a disability.
That's it.
I mean, I can tell you that there are other criteria, but I have never had a student that's been rejected that I recommended.
What should we have learned about?
Check with your case manager. There's probably some sort of a DRS representative within your school, or someone that's going to be your connection to that person. We're an NSCD school, so ours is through our NSCD program.
We're at THS.
Yes, so you should have. Evanston's not part of NSCD. I wish I knew the person, but I could probably find the person for you.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
What about kids that go to private schools?
You should just contact your local school. So whatever your school would be, if your student wasn't going private.
And if they tell you just to contact the DRS office?
Then you could. I mean, you could go through the Arlington Heights or the Waukegan office. I don't know where you're located, so.
How about downstate Illinois?
There's definitely DRS downstate Illinois.
I've never heard of it before, and you're talking about, like, my son attends a community college, and we're just trying to look maybe elsewhere, but.
Absolutely. So look into it. I hesitate if you probably, if you Google DRS.
So
what
DRS county have, like, okay.
Any other questions?